Hi again. If you've been following this channel for a little while, then you know that I've already made a video where I demonstrated that Trotskyism and also the theory of permanent revolution are anti-Leninist and that Lenin opposed them. Now I want to explain why the theory is not only anti-Leninist and opposed by Lenin, but what exactly it is and why it is incorrect. Also, there are a couple of widespread myths peddled by Trotskyists, one in particular that I want to deal with. And I'm sure that as more of these come up, I might also devote another video to dealing with them, but we will see. Now, what is permanent revolution? This theory, albeit not actually terribly complicated, actually depending on your interpretation, is extremely simplistic and almost not even a theory, is subject of much confusion even among Trotskyists, because the language is kind of confusing and the theory itself is kind of confused. But what do I mean by your interpretation? Well, allow me to explain. You see, Trotskyists don't exactly agree what this theory encompasses, and that's also another major reason for this confusion. I admit that I'm not a Trotsky expert, and that I have no idea how widespread these different schools of thought are, other than my own experience talking with Trotskyists. And also, of course, bourgeois sources also have very different definitions of what this means, but you know, I would stick to what Trotskyists say. It doesn't really even matter which definition you follow, as you will soon find out. Basically, the theory encompasses three main aspects: uninterruptedness of the revolution, a lack of trust in the peasantry, and the global nature of the revolution. Note that many Trotskyists don't acknowledge point 2 at all, but some of them do. Some Trotskyists also don't think the global nature of the revolution is part of the theory, but some do. So if you accept the three aspects I mentioned, the theory is not too complicated, but if you only accept the first one, then it's almost non-existent. It doesn't really matter at all if point 3, the global nature of the revolution, is part of the theory, because A, Trotsky emphasizes this issue constantly and in the same text where he formulates the theory of permanent revolution itself, and B, it certainly is still a major component of Trotskyism. You know, whether or not it actually comes with this theory or not, it certainly comes with Trotskyism. Anyway, it's usually associated with the theory, particularly as an alternative in opposition to socialism in one country. Now, let's go over these three aspects one by one. Uninterruptedness of the revolution. Now, what exactly does this mean? It means that the democratic or bourgeois revolution grows into a socialist revolution, that the revolution process is continuous and doesn't stop until the proletariat is in power, although it goes through various different stages and which are more or less intense and involve various different methods of struggle. This is actually not anything unique among Marxists at all, and actually I'm pretty confused why it is that Trotskyists are so infatuated with this. This aspect is literally not denied by anyone, any major Marxist anyway, so I don't know why Trotskyists feel the need to bring it up constantly. The theory of permanent uninterrupted revolution gets its name from this aspect of the theory. Some even say it's all there is to this theory, and it's not even Trotsky's own theory. Which I will explain now. It can barely even be called a theory at all. The term permanent revolution originates from a work by Marx, address of their Central Committee to the Communist League, London, March 1850. Lenin never argued against this aspect, quite the opposite, and same with Stalin. So again, I see no reason to even bring this up, because nobody disagrees with this. Marx, Lenin, and Stalin all explicitly supported this view. Even more confusing is why Trotsky and Trotskyists consider this an original and new theory, because, as I said, this idea was first brought up by Marx, and everyone else also agrees with it, so I don't really see how it's a Trotskyist theory. Although some of them actually do quote both Lenin and Marx in support of this idea, and they try to use that in order to defend the other two aspects of the theory, i.e. because Lenin agreed that the revolution should be uninterrupted, and because Marx thought that it should be uninterrupted, and therefore they supposedly accepted the rest of the, you know, Trotsky's theory, which is ludicrous. Okay, anyway, here is what Marx said on the subject. So this is where the term permanent revolution comes from. Well, the democratic petty bourgeois want to bring the revolution to an end as quickly as possible, achieving at most the aims already mentioned. It is our interest and our task to make the revolution permanent, until all the more or less propertied classes have been driven from their ruling positions, until the proletariat has conquered state power. Their battle cry must be permanent revolution. So yeah, this is where the term comes from, and Trotskyists also like to sometimes quote this this passage like it means anything, like Marx was a Trotskyist or something. All it shows is that Trotsky basically plagiarized Marx. 2. Lack of trust in the peasantry. I already covered this in my previous video on Trotskyism. Basically, Trotsky thought that the peasantry would eventually and inevitably come into a hostile conflict with socialism, and thus it was fundamentally counter-revolutionary and not to be trusted. It would enter into hostile conflict, not only with those bourgeois groups which had supported it during the first stages of its revolutionary struggle, but also with the broad masses of the peasantry, with whose collaboration it, the proletariat, had come into power. Trotsky, preface to 1905. Obviously, this is simply confusing the broad peasant masses with the gulags, and this is something I already explained in my previous video, but in case you haven't seen that, the broad peasant masses never came into such a conflict with socialism that wasn't possible to remedy by correct policy. This is an extremely dangerous and incorrect view proposed by Trotskyism, which isolates the Communist Party from the broad peasant masses, handing them over to the side of reaction. It is a self-fulfilling prophecy. Instead, the small peasant was largely on the side with socialism, while the middle peasant could be won over to socialism, thus isolating the kulak. Because basically, kulaks were reactionary, the small peasant was revolutionary, and the middle peasant vacillated between the two positions. And because Trotsky thought that they were all reactionary, especially the middle peasant and the kulak, his policy of being hostile towards the middle peasantry would have driven them to team up with the kulaks. So therefore, it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. You treat them like reactionaries, you turn them into reactionaries, basically. 3. The global nature of the revolution. Trotsky didn't believe in socialism in one country. That is clear. And it's also clear that Lenin firmly supported socialism in one country, as I demonstrated in my previous video. Uneven economic and political development is an absolute law of capitalism. Hence, the victory of socialism is possible first in several or even in one capitalist country alone. After expropriating the capitalists and organizing their own socialist production, the victorious proletariat of that country will arise against the rest of the world, the capitalist world. Lenin on the slogan for a United States of Europe. There he clearly says it, you know, one or several countries revolt, they organize socialist production, and then they fight the rest of the world. I think it's pretty much as clear as it gets. However, one thing I didn't mention was that one of the reasons Trotsky didn't accept socialism in one country was not only because he was maybe more pessimistic, had a lack of faith in the leadership of the proletariat and thought the peasantry was reactionary, but he also had an anti-Leninist definition of socialism. In his view, in socialism, there was no state and no party. He also didn't think cooperatives were socialist. Therefore, he didn't see the USSR as socialist because it had collective, non-state-owned farms, it had a party, and it had a state. Stalin argued for socialism in one country and against Trotsky convincingly, but it's worth noting they had different definitions. Stalin used the Leninist definition that socialism was a transitional stage between capitalism and communism, where the state existed and it would only begin to wither away in communism. He also considered the collective farms on state land using state machines to be socialist, as Lenin did. It is this very circumstance that is underestimated by many of our practical workers. They look down upon cooperative societies, failing to appreciate their exceptional importance. First, from the standpoint of principle, the means of production are owned by the state, and second, from the standpoint of transition to the new system by means that are the simplest, easiest, and most acceptable to the peasant. But this again is a fundamental importance. It is one thing to draw out fantastic plans for building socialism through all sorts of workers' associations, and quite another to learn to build socialism practice in such a way that every small peasant could take part in it. Lenin on cooperation. Yeah, so Trotsky definitely didn't see it that way. He didn't really think that this was socialism. Trotsky's permanent revolution is essentially a Menshevik theory. When the theory of permanent revolution by Trotsky was formulated, the issue at hand was the democratic revolution in Russia. Everyone agreed that the next step was a bourgeois democratic revolution. What they disagreed on was the role of the proletariat, the role of the peasantry, and what would happen after the bourgeois democratic revolution. Here I've written down the positions of Menshevism, Bolshevism, i.e. Leninism, and Trotskyism, and their key aspects, so you may compare. First of all, Menshevism. There is a democratic revolution led by the bourgeois that the proletariat supports. Then they wait for capitalism to develop properly until a socialist revolution, and therefore socialism is possible. Bolshevism. Again, a democratic revolution, but led by the proletariat instead of the bourgeois, that grows into a socialist revolution, then a prolonged construction towards socialism, and finally achievement of socialism in one or more countries. And then there's the Trotskyist view. Democratic revolution led by the proletariat, not by the bourgeois, that grows into a socialist revolution, but socialism is not possible in one country and is not achieved or strived for. Instead, they just, pursue capitalist development. So, Trotskyism agrees with Leninism that the proletariat needs to assume the leading role in the democratic revolution. It also agrees with Leninism that the revolution will have to grow into a socialist one. However, it agrees with Menshevism on the role of the peasantry, also because according to Trotskyism, socialism is not possible in one country, but will have to happen in at least several more advanced countries. It ultimately leads to the same thing as Menshevism, which is capitalism. Menshevism just assumes that capitalism has to develop fully before the socialist revolution should take place for socialism to happen. Trotsky argues that the revolution should take place, but instead of building socialism, they should just stick with developing capitalism, unless, of course, the revolution spreads. Therefore, Trotsky's permanent revolution is essentially a Menshevik theory. April Theses. It's a popular myth among Trotskyists that Lenin adopted Trotsky's theory of permanent revolution in April of 1917 in his famous April Theses. This originates from an incorrect understanding of the Leninist position on the relationship between the democratic and socialist revolution. It might be hard to imagine how they can actually think this, but when I'm done, I think you should be able to understand it pretty clearly. Here I must explain the Leninist view on this subject. According to Lenin, there needs to be a democratic revolution led by the proletariat that pushes for a revolutionary provisional government to replace absolutism or feudalism such as czarism. This revolutionary government would of course consist of the democratic bourgeois elements, peasants, workers and all the democratic forces, not only the proletariat. This is what they pushed for already in 1905. Well, in February of 1917, they got such a government. Why didn't they participate and instead adopted the slogan of no support for the provisional government? Isn't this Trotskyism? Didn't Lenin change his position and adapt Trotsky's theory? No, Lenin made it clear that they needed to push for a revolutionary provisional government and participate in it, if it was at all possible. In 1917, it eventually became clear that this was not possible, hence the reason Lenin wrote his April Theses. Trotskyists often make a lot of noise about Stalin's supposed mistake on this subject. However, as you can see in this video, this was not a mistake or a disagreement on principle, but a question of strategy. The party at first had a policy of conditional support for the provisional government, and the reasons should be clear. At that time, I shared this mistaken position with other party comrades, and fully abandoned it only in the middle of April when I associated myself with Lenin's thesis, J.V. Stalin 1924, Trotskyism or Leninism. Then what about the Soviets? Lenin had argued since 1905 that they should not only participate in the provisional government if it was at all possible and exercise pressure from above, but also exercise, quote, permanent pressure from below by armed workers in order to consolidate and protect the gains of the democratic revolution. Irrespective whether the participation of social democrats in the provisional revolutionary government proved possible or not, we must propagate among the broadest masses of the proletariat the necessity for permanent pressure to be brought to bear upon the provisional government by the armed proletariat led by the Social Democratic Party for the purpose of defending, consolidating and extending the gains of the revolution. The Third Congress of the Russian Social Democratic Labor Party. Extending those gains and moving towards the socialist revolution, that is. We must exercise pressure on the provisional revolutionary government from below in any case. In order to be able to exercise this pressure from below, the proletariat must be armed. For in a revolutionary situation, matters develop with exceptional rapidity, to the stage of open civil war and must be led by the Social Democratic Party. The object of its armed pressure is that of defending, consolidating and extending the gains of the revolution. Lenin: Two Tactics of Social Democracy in the Democratic Revolution. In October, it had long been clear that the provisional government was completely reactionary and that they'd have enough strength in the Soviets to not only pressure it, but pressure it enough to overthrow it and in its place establish a real revolutionary provisional government and not a counter-revolutionary provisional government, a dictatorship of the proletariat and the peasantry on its path towards socialism. This has nothing to do with Trotskyism, and Trotsky deserves no praise for Lenin's brilliant theory, nor for his plagiarism and distortion of Marx in order to create his own original, quote-unquote, original theory of permanent revolution. Now, does this theory actually work? That depends. If you mean that the peasantry is reactionary and that socialism can't be built in one country, then it obviously doesn't. But if you only mean that the revolution should be uninterrupted, then yes. The thing is, I've already explained that that is not in any way a new or unique idea and has nothing to do with Trotskyism.